Back in 1992, an older friend of my father who was from St. Louis asked me to go to this meeting that the Communist Party USA was having at the University of California, Berkeley. And he had studied communism and written books about communism back in the 60s and stuff. And he was curious because if you'll remember back in 1989, the Berlin Wall had come down and everyone was saying communism is dead, it's over. Then in 91, in December, the Soviet Union dissolved. And so this is 6 months later, the summer of 92, and the Communist Party USA is having a meeting. So he asked me to go out to this meeting. He said, would you go out there and just see what they're talking about? Because we won. This thing's over. And so I went to that. And for 3 days, I sat there in breakout sessions and lectures and listened to these hardcore communists. And one thing shocking about it too, I thought it'd be college radical since it was at Berkeley. So I dressed like a college radical with some radical t-shirt on. So I walk into the auditorium. There's 1,400 or 1,500 50, 60, and 70-year-olds with briefcases. And I thought, whoa, this is actually serious. It's not just some radicals. And many of those exact people, as I researched them later, ended up being in Obama's cabinet in 2008. And that's what motivated me to make the movie, because I realized, wait, these are the people that were at this communist meeting with me back in 1992. But at that meeting, they laid out this plan, how they wanted to take America down from the inside. They were going to focus all their energies on that now. They'd been focusing on it for a while, but they realized they could never outspend America because capitalism and free enterprise is so successful. And they kind of, that woke them up. Okay, we got to go to plan B. They just keep building more and more. And of course, we had all the years of Reagan where he'd really built the military up. So they realized we're in trouble here. And so that's what they talked about, the meeting, how they were going to do that from the inside. And I didn't think that much about it, went on with my life. But then again, 16 years later, in 2008 from 92, when I remembered what they had talked about, like one thing that is so clear how it had changed. They had said back in 92, we're going to use the environmental movement to take down the free enterprise system in America. And in 92, that didn't make sense because that was not a big movement. It was literally people, you know, chaining themselves to trees in Oregon so they can't cut them down. I mean, it was nothing. And so I was like, how would you do that? But in 2008, An Inconvenient Truth by Al Gore had come out. It was the biggest movement in the world, and it still is, because they realized it's the ultimate vehicle for totalitarian control, because it's a global problem, so it demands global solutions by a global government. That's the way they look at it. That's why that issue will never go away, no matter how many facts we have and how many charts we can show them. Hey, it's not going up, and if it went up a little bit, it actually would be good. Warmth is the friend of life. Cold is the enemy of life. All the logical things that they don't. But from that, I wrote a letter when I was a representative on that communist meeting in 1992, and it just blew up into a huge thing. And one of the men that responded to that and said, what Representative Bauer says is true, but it's nothing new. That's not from 1992. It was all written in a book in 1958. And I got to know the man, and it was, of course, the book, The Naked Communist. And it had the 45 current communist goals as of the 1950s in America. And I got that book for the first time in 2008, so 50 years later. And I read through the list of goals. And as I did, I couldn't believe how specific and how purposeful and how premeditated the collapse of our country had been. It had been people and groups for 100 years working to take us down from within. And I couldn't believe, as I read through these things, one of them, Goal 17. This is from 50s America. Get control of the schools, use them as transmission belts for socialism, soften the curriculum. Well, people wonder, why do all the kids want socialism today? Because in the 50s, they said, we got to put socialist ideas, we got to push it. So these kids think it's good and think it's wonderful. And so, because they know, all the hardcore communists know, you have to transition through socialism before you can go to communism. You cannot go from a prosperous free enterprise system to communism, because the problem is, in the prosperous free enterprise system, you and all the people own all the stuff. Mm-hmm. And so they can't, it's like, how do we get this? They have the wealth, they have the guns, they have the property, they have, we got to transition into socialism where we slowly get control of everything. And then it's easy to flip overnight, especially if you can disarm them. Then overnight, it's no more Mr. Nice Guy. You do what we say or you get a bullet in your head. Mm-hmm. I mean, and that happened over and over again throughout the 20th century. So it's not like some new strategy. That's what they did to most of the countries that fell fell to communism, and a lot of people don't know this, during the 20th century, like 65 or 70 countries that fell, that's how they fell. They did not, the tanks didn't roll in and take them over. They stirred up, their radicals stirred up the college professors to stir up the young people for freedom, it's not a just government, because it wasn't a perfect government, whatever country it might have been, like Cuba or something. No, it wasn't a perfect government, but it was pro-American, they had a lot of freedom, they were prosperous, but the people there stirred it up and said no. And so when what happens is the communists do that, then they put up their puppet as the guy that's for the people, and the people usually vote that person into power, and then once they get the levers of control, the iron fist comes out, and like Castro did, it started slaughtering by the thousands anyone who resisted in Cuba. Yeah, they've been brainwashed, that toxic masculinity, yeah. Because they knew that's their number one enemy.
Yeah.
Back in the 1930s, even the Frankfurt School, one of the groups that my movie talks about, they talked about that. They said, we're never going to be able to get these children away from the parents in the families where the father is leading the home. They go, we got to pull him out. We got to get him sidetracked on other things, sports or whatever. And then we got to create enough inflation so the mother has to work whether she wants to or not so we can raise the children. Mm-hmm. They were writing about that in the 1930s.
And now you have them on the White House podium saying, these are our children.
Exactly.
These are not your children. No. They're our children.
That's right.
You know, coming from the White House.
Yeah. That's right.
Legitimately, like 3 months ago.
You know, one thing that I always think back to is, right, like every now and then you'll see one of these pictures pop up. So this is a picture of like a 17-year-old in Vietnam, mm-hmm. right? And like knowing that like that was the normal here. Right. Like just this peak male. Right. Like, I mean, he's 17 year olds. He's got muscle tone and he's out fighting a war. You know what I'm saying? Compared to what our 17 year olds look like now, they're dressing up as fur babies and furries and stuff. It's like, how do we get there? Like, and it could like, and to just, you know, for this conversation, it couldn't just be this one way that we got to this place. It's all these different facets on all these different fronts that they've been able to use to get us to exactly where we are right now. And it's not an overnight process, right? Like, no. They've been planning this stuff for years.
Oh, yeah. It's been going on in earnest for right at about 100 years.